Instructional Designers in Offices Drinking Coffee is brought to you by dominKnow, makers of dominKnow One, the all-in-one cloud-based e-learning authoring tool for teams. You can learn more at dominKnow.com. That's dominKnow.com. Now, here's this week's episode.
Good morning, everybody.
Oh, hey, gang. How's everybody doing in the chat?
Look at all the folks in there dropping in all of a sudden. Bang! Look at that.
Boom.
Let's get a weather report from everybody.
It is sunny and bright but cool, a classic fall day here in Eastern Ontario. Folks, why don't you come on out, walk around, and look at the leaves as they turn. Come on, everybody. Come on up.
I like the virtual hugs.
Yep.
Very nice, very nice, very nice.
Sunny and cold in the UK, Lightbulb Joe says. Joe, I think most people would say, oh, no, sunny and cold. No, most people would expect overcast and cold, right? So you're having a bit of a different day then. Jack, hey Jack, we haven't had you join us in the chat for a while. It is beautiful out today, isn't it, Jack?
Well, looky there.
Oh, Christina's saying Toronto's overcast, which here in Eastern Ontario means that in like 4 hours we'll be overcast, because that's the way the weather moves. 4 to 6 hours. So awesome. Well, now that we've got the weather out of the way and all of our technical problems, guys, we have technical problems sometimes. That might surprise some of you. That might surprise some of the folks who know us as consummate professionals, and perfection is always our motto. Anyway, we got past those, and we have a first time guest with us here today, Amy K. Czechowicz, and I mangled that a little bit, didn't I? I did.
You were so close.
You practiced it so well.
Amy K. Czechowicz, right? There we go.
Czechowicz, yeah. Czechowicz, you know.
Czechowicz.
Close. Yeah.
I apologize.
It's all good.
We're working on that, and I apologize. Amy, give us a bit of introduction to yourself. Tell us a little bit about your background, how you got into this world that we all seem to love so much, and introduce yourselves to our friends in the chat.
Absolutely. Good morning, everyone. My name is Amy K. Czechowicz, and I am... I call myself a continuous improvement enthusiast, first and foremost. That's what I would say is my strongest identity. I bridge that through learning and workforce development through the value that I see in adult learning theory and that really cool alignment between continuous improvement, which believes that those who do the work make the best solutions, and then how do we actually empower people to do that? What do they need to know? So I have been paid to think about how to help other people do continuous improvement for over 8 years. I have been paid to help other people learn how to do their jobs better, period, for over 10 years. And it's something I really love. I love to talk about it. I get very passionate about it. I grew up on a dairy farm in Wisconsin. I live in Minneapolis. I live in a suburb of Minneapolis now. And I think a lot of what I went through growing up and just seeing my parents make business decisions, make data-informed business decisions over and over again, and I got to see it and be a part of it, is really what drives where I come from in as an instructional designer and as a continuous improvement enthusiast.
Mm-hmm. Very cool.
The reference to the data-driven and dairy, I for a period of about a decade lived beside a dairy farm, and the family rolled out a new barn, and they had an open house, and we went over to see, and I was blown away. This would be 15 years ago already. The amount of data, every cow that lined up into a milking stall had a chip, and that data was being monitored over there in that room, for every, you know, every drop of milk, basically, et cetera, and all the feeding profiles and everything. And I was, you know, literally jaw hit the floor. I'm like, holy cow, this is not, I grew up in the rurals you know, we'd go to friends' houses, et cetera, but this is not the milking parlor of my youth. so holy cow, data.
Holy cow.
Holy cow. Very appropriate.
Geez.
Wait a minute. I'm late on the draw.
That one just slipped out. I wasn't even thinking of that. I can't help myself, I guess.
I did that one just for Craig. He hates the sound effects.
we got one in the chat.
Oh, Joe, crushing it on the puns for sure.
Yep.
So let's move on now to something else and
I think it's a good transition, though. I think it's actually a very fantastic segue from, you know, understanding all of the data and figuring all of that stuff out and learning it at a young age and getting into your career now and understanding the impact that it has on performance improvement and understanding that everything out in the corporate world revolves around the business and the data that supports and drives the decisions within the business. This is something that our industry has discussed and talked about for probably a decade plus, at least as long as I've been in it. But I think everybody still kind of scratches their heads, and that's not really the topic of today. But, you know, part of that is engaging with the management. And so I think it all blends together so nicely. And just to kind of give folks a little bit of background about how you and I got connected, you really enjoyed listening to one of our other podcasts or one of our other shows and our other guests. And why don't you take the story over from there?
Yeah. So it was a while ago. I think it wasn't it 2019, maybe? I was listening to Mike Kunkel. Am I right about the timing? Yeah. 2019?
I think maybe it was early 2020. Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
It was during COVID because Mike's dog, Frank.
Oh, okay.
Okay. That's right. He crawled on the back of his chair and kind of sat on his shoulders.
Well, I really enjoyed Mike's talk because he emphasized what had been going in my mind through this cohort experience that I'd been doing. And he talked about how in his way that he designs his learning journeys, he specifically looks at when management need to be engaged, how to include them. And I thought about my cohort that I had just piloted in January. And I had it was a pilot. I had 15 learners, you know, very small sample size. But I noticed a consistency, unfortunately, was that I had, in the end, 4 people drop. And, you know, in a small cohort, that really makes a big difference. I had done a lot of recruiting and ensuring, you know, that the learners were set. And each one, when they were dropping, they were telling me how sad they were and that it wasn't their decision. It was their manager's decision, that their manager didn't see the value or that something else was being prioritized. So maybe their manager saw the value, but something else was given the priority. And so then I heard this talk and I thought, that's it. You know, those are the pieces. And obviously in my pilot, I did a ton of data gathering to make sure that I wasn't making spurious conclusions. And I looked at what do people actually tell us about the support they need. And I went even bigger to my larger sample size because I query after everyone takes a workshop, even the short workshops and not the cohort. I ask everybody, what do they need to be supported in applying what they learned from the workshop. And I did a Pareto analysis because I was just like, well, let's see. The number one, by far the biggest category of my qualitative theming showed support for management. And the second category was for the rest of my teammates to know this too, which I feel like, you know, there's a lot of overlap right there.
Sure.
And so, for the second go round, I was really motivated and actually over halfway through right now. But I did a lot of things differently, you can imagine, right? I applied my continuous improvement. I looked at what data-informed decision-making. And so I really built in to my learning journey, just as Mike suggests, where where was I going to work and talk with the management, and how was I going to communicate that? And then also, where were the learner going to keep the manager engaged in what they were gaining skills in? Because I think you need both. And I do have a, is this a good time to share my synthesized thoughts?
Absolutely.
All right.
Yes.
All right. So I have a visual. And we'll do the entire screen, and then I'll just switch. I pulled it up in a PDF, so we'll see double for a little bit. Right here. Can you see it?
Yeah, that's perfect.
Yep, totally. Yep.
All right. And there were a couple keys that I really felt were leading to success. And so far, just in case you're curious, we are now over halfway done with the program. So this time in the pilot, we had had 100% of all drops. So we only had the 4 drops total out of the 15, which is a lot. But by this time in the pilot, we had already had 4 drops. This time on the second go around where I applied these things, anyone want to take a guess on how many drops I've had?
Zero.
Zero. Zero drops. Yes, you are right. So I really think big piece is making the case. You talked about this already, Brent, a little bit, that, you know, when managers are making decisions, they're making decisions from the big picture standpoint. And when employees are signing up for learning, when staff are considering their development, oftentimes they're thinking smaller picture. And so when they go to make the case, they don't always draw the line to connect the dots for their management on, you know what, this is also good because I'm going to stick around. Or this is good because I'm learning what's going to help the organization as well. This actually has a, we'll share this with folks, right? I think we will.
Sure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep. For sure.
Has a clickable link from the Gallup study that says this. And so I really think that this is a key, that when we're helping staff explain why they want to do a particular development, we should give them the words that help them make the case to their manager. Also, the applied learning. This one I really love, because I think that this was a big reason why, for the folks who didn't drop in the pilot, the outcomes were amazing. They loved it, really, really enjoyed it. And one of the challenges that they faced sometimes was just being able to apply what we were talking about to their day job. And that was the whole point, you know, from the very beginning when people signed up, it's about continuous improvement, coaching continuous improvement. They really, you know, and I subscribe to the 70-20-10. I don't know, do you too like the 70-20-10 model?
I think the 70-20-10 model reflects more of a pragmatic reality of the way that things do work. And then when sometimes people do take it then as a way of sort of forming and shaping the learning. Certainly not everything gets answered successfully by formal learning, which we, you know mm-hmm. is the 10. So
it yeah, helps, right. I think it helps explain, or it helps start the conversation with managers and with other people mm-hmm. when you're trying to explain, like, for example, you know, social learning or informal learning and stuff like that, when people scratch their heads and they're like, well, what are you talking about? And to use 70-20-10, I think it helps a lot there.
Sure.
It just helps in conversations. In my personal experience, I've never actually used it as a framework and tried to actually hit those numbers for anybody or anything like that.
But yeah.
The visual is good for new people that are new to the concept. Yeah.
Yeah. And I like it because it aligns a lot with, you know, in adult learning theory, when you talk about experiential learning, that's the whole point. Like, you can have experiential learning in a classroom. It's amazing, right? But just giving that nod to, guess what? Adult learners, people who already know some stuff, they're going to do better with their mental models if they're in that position where they can apply what they already know to what you're trying to tell them. And we know that's true, right? So application is really key. And I had some instances where folks just weren't being given the support that they needed to actually apply what they were learning. And in a cohort model, especially, like, that was part of the promise I was kind of making. And so I realized I had made an error in the pilot by not asking managers to be a part of that, that actually managers are the ones who create that space for learners to do mm-hmm. that. And then, sorry, we're gonna ask a follow up.
There have been other studies too, you know, just showing that management involvement in not necessarily directly taking, say, in, the training, but is also a key to success overall. You can throw training at people, but if it doesn't work itself back into what people are doing and isn't being observed, then you don't even know how to measure something ultimately, for instance.
Right. Absolutely. At that point, you're just guessing. Right. And there's a great quote from Suhail Doshi. He says, people who make decisions on their gut or by feeling alone are either lucky or wrong. I love that quote.
That is a good one.
So, and then lastly, and you know, all along this, what we've been saying is help managers help you, meaning help managers help the learning journey. Because if we do tell managers specifically, well, guess what? In this, you know, here's what your staff is going to get out of it. Here's what they need to be successful. Here's what would be the actions that you could take to make sure that your staff is successful, you know, and that's even in this time we've had calendar conversations where the at the start of every 4-week module, the learner sits down and does a content related conversation with their manager, one to one. And I write them up, you know, it's structured, but also I do that intentionally so that they're talking about the content that they're learning and it's not being pushed to the back burner. And then demonstrating the relevance to the organization goals. We already talked about this a little bit at the beginning, but just use learning and development best practice to prove that your outcomes are working. There's a really sad Harvard Business Review article right now. I should have gathered the link, but it basically says that right now there's that we have a paradox. We're at an all-time high for leadership in organizations believing that training can help their organizations do better, and an all-time low at learners and managers being satisfied with the learning that they're getting. Isn't that so sad?
It's a huge
gulf. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, there's so many factors in that. I mean, partly it's the traditional way that training departments are often a thing over here, you're given orders on what's needed for training as opposed to being involved, for instance, in the decision making and the analysis of what's needed kind of process. And the fact that everybody, I think in a lot of cases, already knows how training should be done anyway, because we all grew up in school and we all, you know, then went off into the world and experienced, training experiences. And so we all know that it's somebody standing at the front of the room and telling us things or what have you, you know, those kinds of, so there's so many factors. It's a constant, it's a constant theme here on idiotic, how do we break out of that mold and prove our worth and our value.
Right. And I'm not, Kirkpatrick's model or, you know, there's lots of ways to do it. And this kind of gets back to our dairy farm, right? You could know which cows were giving the milk that had the most milk fat, which, you know, you get more money for more milk fat. We want to know which learning is actually being effective. And I think that takes effort, but it's worth it. Definitely worth it. I think it helps us make the case all along. And to your point about the strategic alignment, if you can show that the development opportunities that you're creating are aligned to the strategic aims of the organization, that's going to only just make your job easier.
So do we start a trend and convince people to start calling their value add milk fat?
that might need some explanation.
I don't think that's going to go over so well, but I totally get it. You know, one of the things I was thinking of too, from a management perspective, like we always tend to have these conversations around the perspective of the instructional designer, right, and the individual contributor that's reporting up to the manager, right, and all of our issues that we have. And we rarely think about it from the manager's side, which is really nice in this situation because this allows us to put ourselves in their shoes. And when I start thinking about sort of what really I think is the underlying feature, if you will, of this particular strategy is that you, as the instructor or the person building the training or selling the training, you know, however it works within your organization, if you're internal, if you're an external, whatnot, then managers always feel more important than their people, right? It's just the state of hierarchies. Mm-hmm. And so if you don't engage them, then of course everything that is on their plate is the most important thing what's on their people's plates. But when you engage them and when you connect with them and you build a personal relationship with the management, now they have something invested. They have a personal investment. They know who you are. They know your name. They know your face, you know, and when all you have to do at that point is drop a few, hey, here's some value adds for you that your people are going to get out of this. And I'd really love to get your feedback later to see if the people that take the training actually apply it. Now, all of a sudden that manager is like, oh,
yeah,
this is it. They're going to the training, but I'm the one getting all the value from it. Yeah. They might now start prioritizing that differently. And it all starts with that relationship that I think sort of gets lost in a lot of the work that we do.
Right. They have a role. And I really thought of it just as you're describing, Brent, like I really thought of it as onboarding the manager. In just the same way that you onboard the learner. Yeah. I made an onboarding plan for the managers. And that's one thing I wrote. I said, at the end, you know, I'm going to ask you too. I'm definitely asking the learner, obviously, what they got out of this. And I'm going to ask you, because then they do feel that role. And hopefully they play a part. And obviously it's happening because I'm seeing the results right now.
Right on. I think we should have called this episode Onboarding Your Manager. Dang, we missed a perfect opportunity there.
Yeah. I think we often at the start of a course or a project or whatever, we have the, you know, what's in it for me, helping the learner, you know, picture the value. But there's also got to be a what's in it for me for the manager, too, for them to understand and get you with some buy-in. So when you've done, you did the pilot version and now you've made some adjustments working towards the management, management level of things. Do you have a sense of like, how much additional time does this take in terms of say planning?
For the planning and like figuring out how I wanted to onboard, it took, I maybe had to spend another 5% of the time that it took me in the pilot to really be intentional. And that's, I have a strategic brain. I like to think strategically. So that's probably the amount of time that I put into it. Now I am doing this cohort is mostly asynchronous. It's 75% asynchronous. And so I use, I record videos and then have people react to it. And that's how I did the onboarding for management. And then message them, obviously, personally, and then had a couple of one-to-one conversations with the folks who had questions. And then I think through that, it's maybe added less than 2% across the actual 16-week cohort.
Oh, that's cool. Because that's something that people, I think a lot of us hear, well, that's awesome to do, but how much time is it going to take me to do that on top of everything that I'm already, doing and that focus of,
yeah.
I don't want to leave people with the sense that, that this is necessarily an overburdensome, even though the results, are beneficial and strategic, et cetera, but still,
yeah.
Oh, there's more for me to do.
Right. It can be worrying, but thankfully, yeah. I think if you figure out the right message to send, you can minimize your time. And I'm just so happy that, now I can see week to week, I've had 100% or, I have had zero drops. So it's effective. Definitely. Very cool.
Mm-hmm. The first item there about giving people, the information that they need to talk to, their manager about the learners, is that just that you were reshaping, say, the description of the program or how did you help them? And I guess the second question related to that is the program something that your learners are choosing to take and therefore have to make a case, or is it something that they are being assigned
yeah.
to?
Yeah. Awesome questions. It is voluntary, first of all, which I have, done both sides, both voluntary and involuntary learning. And I always find that even though voluntary learning sometimes is more difficult for us to get management buy-in. It's often, I feel like, more transformational, and you don't have to fight as much to get people to engage. So people are signing up for this. It's coaching continuous improvement. So it's people who already have some ability with continuous improvement, and they want to be able to effectively lead others through it. So there's an element of leadership. You know, one whole module covers how we actually lead and what that looks like typically in continuous improvement. And usually it is informal. You don't actually have any authority. You're just supposed to get stuff done. And so what I mean by the creating interactions where learners speak to their managers is that as an instructional designer, the more we can help the learners cover what is, I think, the value add, the milk fat, the more we can help them speak to that, I think the management is going to keep hearing, oh yeah, this is worthwhile. This aligns to our strategic aims of our organization. This time that the learner is spending, and it's only an hour and a half per week across the 16 weeks, by the way, that's the intention. So if you can help the learner make that case, I think that we're doing our due diligence as instructional designers to really make this learning the most effective that it can be. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, no, very cool. And actually, right. I appreciated. No, and the bit more elaboration on the program itself also helps give us a sense of what people are involved in. Certainly something that's voluntary. If someone wants it, there's already an intrinsic motivation to learn. So that's, absolutely. Yes. That's our, they're creating their own teachable moments, right? By wanting
that's right.
And recognizing the value for themselves as a learner versus being condemned to, told to take something. is required anyway.
We often also discuss things like ROI, right, and all of that kind of stuff. And I think as a consultant or a contractor, your ROI is in people not dropping, right? I mean, that's the proof's in the pudding there, as they say, right?
Yeah.
I mean, if you can keep more people attending, obviously you're going to, make more money on your end. If you're internal, that attendance is going to then return value in more people getting the learning and experiencing the training. So, I mean, there's nothing but upside in what seems like a very little extra effort on our part to just come up with that strategy or build the onboarding of the manager into your overall strategy. Cause it was funny. I'm glad you really brought it to that point. And I'm glad Chris asked the question too, because my first thought was when we were mentioning it was, I can sense the eye rolls in the chat of people going, geez, more work for me. Are you kidding me? But you're right. It's that value is huge. And I think when we explain it like that, at least I hope, I don't know, you guys in the chat, tell me if you rolled your eyes and if you feel better about it now, I don't know.
Yeah. What are we thinking? And it's hard sometimes, you talked about making the case and the ROI. Actually, I have this open just because this is one of my, I'm in the last semester of my MBA program, and this was one of the articles that I came across just in my research for the program. And Devarakonda actually figured out a way to measure ROI for learning. It's not milk fat, but in this study, they came up with 1.37. So for every dollar invested in the program, the ROI is $1.374. And what I like about this, so I don't know if you're familiar with Mark Friedman's results-based accountability, but I really enjoy that for public sector work in particular, because it's very common, and if you've ever watched his YouTube video, but it's very common for government, for public sector to be willing to measure what do we do and how well do we do it. And that final question, is anyone better off, right? This is where we're saying, okay, well, when management want to know, is anyone better off? Is anyone in our organization? Is our customers, how do we actually measure that? And I feel like, I don't know, I enjoy this paper because you can see how much in depth, and I feel like it's a good place for people to start if you're just trying to figure it out.
Yeah. What's the name of that research again? We've got a question in the chat. Sure. Somebody wanted to know. And if you happen to have a link for that, or do you just have did you just download? I'm sure it's hard to find.
I got it through school, you know, I'm in the in crowd with the academia.
If it's a PDF, or maybe you can just drag the title and paste that into the chat.
Yeah, I'll do that.
People can do a search and find some where they might
see if you
get
can.
It.
Right. And maybe you could email. I mean, they got their email right here. So anyhow, I just thought that was relevant because just thinking about, well, how do we make the case? Well, other people have done it. You know what I mean? Sometimes it is difficult, and I find it's always worth it.
I think even just a little bit of extra effort. I mean, I think people can take baby steps, right? If you're feeling like you're overwhelmed and like, oh my gosh, I can't possibly add another thing onto my list of things that I do for my programs. Something as simple as maybe just crafting an email and continuously updating the manager, right? Like maybe if it's a long program, like what you're doing, like if it's cohort learning, like, every Friday you send them an update. Here's what your people learned today, or you know, prior to the event, here's what they're going to learn. Here's the value to you. Just little tiny things. Keep it really short. Get something that's, because managers hate to read long verbose emails. So keep it short, keep it sweet, right? Drop it in there. And you know, maybe they read it, maybe they don't, but I think something like that is a great place to start, right? And leveling up might be something like you know, scheduling a meeting with them just one time before it starts and getting to know them so they know who you are and they have a conversation with you and they feel competent in your abilities to train their people. So that might be, that's extra time, but that levels them up, you know, and so you can go from there, I think. So I hope people don't feel like this is going to be too burdensome.
Right. And just as you said, like, choose your own adventure, pick what you want to try. And one thing, so I talk about the five I's of continuous improvement. And one of the I's that I talk about is incremental over breakthrough. Pick little increments, because oftentimes if you try to do the breakthrough change, you're going to get overwhelmed and you're probably going to give up. But if you do incremental little baby steps across time, you're going to feel that you can make the change happen, and it's going to be effective in the long run, more effective in the long run.
I'm a big fan of incremental everything. baby steps are my jam.
Yes.
I mean, it ties in with so many other pieces of what we, you know, what we do, incremental, or we call it scaffolding or whatever. You know, just so many other things that it parallels so many other things that we already do. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And also just the idea there of like, instead of staring at the whole mountain, let's just break it down.
I think
break
I have
it down into parts and
I have it right here. Those are my five eyes. Yeah. Because anytime I work with someone and they want to do continuous improvement, or they're asking me, usually they're asking me like, hey, I'm doing continuous improvement. Am I actually doing continuous improvement? And I listen for these five things. And usually I can tell you which gets skipped. It's either
Can you expand that to be full screen a little bit there? Sorry, don't mean to interrupt it.
It's all good. Let's
this
see.
This is a great way to go, but I just want people to be able to see it.
There
we go. Something like that's good. Yeah.
Yeah. So usually if they're going to skip something, it's the fourth one right there. I'm writing a book about this, by the way. I've got an outline, but informed by data is the one that usually, if people are going to skip something, in my experience, that's what they're going to skip, which, you know, hurts my milk fat loving measuring self. And then the other thing that I see get skipped most often is the initiated and implemented by staff. And usually that happens when we have a manager who's super excited about their own idea. And so they say, okay, you're doing continuous improvement, but it's my idea. And, you know, you have to make it happen. And if you don't have it initiated and implemented by staff, right, all the buy-in goes, I mean, not all the buy-in, but you're going to lose a lot of buy-in. And it's possible that you're not going to be going in the correct direction, right? Because we know that those who do the work, they're right up close to it. They have a perfect view to see what solutions might be possible. So anyhow, but those are my five eyes. I feel like they tell me a lot.
Yes. And maybe just for the, because we have lots of folks who listen to us, maybe just get you to read through those so that we have that tucked in.
Yeah, absolutely. My five eyes of continuous improvement. So how I know when continuous improvement is happening is, number one, is it iterative? And I don't care. I'm not a purist. It could be any cycle of continuous improvement, just following the scientific method. You know, it can be plan, do, check, act, plan, do, study, adjust, define, measure, analyze, improve, control, your theory of constraints, whatever cycle of learning you choose, just it has to be iterative. The second one is impacts the customer. And again, you don't have to use the word customer, but think about people you serve. So it impacts that true north. What are we actually trying to do? Third one is initiated and implemented by staff. Fourth is informed by data. The fifth one is incremental over breakthrough, which brought us here.
Nice. Very cool.
Very, very cool.
Yeah. So if, what would you suggest to people, I guess, as a first step for moving in this direction? What would be a good first thing to do?
I think make a plan that you can actually do. Try to keep it less than 5% of effort, because I do agree that if you try something too big, you might burn out right away. But even just when I went back to look at my my data that I had from the pilot, I had collected, you know, what could be done differently to better support the interaction you had between your manager and yourself. And people had fantastic ideas. And some of them were like, make sure that my manager knows what we're learning and why it's of value. You know, and I could say, oh, well, you're the learner. You should be communicating that. I don't talk to your manager. You should make that case. But no, that this is where I say, you know, I'm not responsible for everything, but I can respond to everything. And I think that's a part of it where I can say, you know what, it is easy for me to make an onboarding and just, you know, spend a little bit of time, package something up that helps management see their role and know the value and send it their way. And I think just starting as simple as that is the way to go.
Very cool. And we should keep in mind, I mean, once you've done that effort, it's repeatable. You don't have to redo that.
That's right.
You know, the next time, but that gives you then a foundation. And then what are you going to change and do to improve and review it and tweak and modify for the next go around on something.
That's right.
Are there any, and this might sound like a dumb question, but are there any places where this might not be a good strategy? I'm not even sure if I can think of
it. Well, I mean, I'm all for avoiding allness, right? The concept that any one thing ever applies to every. I have a poem about it, actually. I also write poems, and I have a poem about allness. And I would say there probably is. I don't know when it is.
Yeah.
And it's probably out there, you know. I can't think of a time right now, but maybe the chat can. Maybe they can help us out.
Yeah. I'm just thinking about the range of things that we're asked to be involved in, you know, as instructional designers. I mean, even if it's someone's doing a course on how to use a software tool, being able to report back to your manager a cycle that says, you know, here are three things that I actually used. Not just the end of the course, what are three things you want to use, but a period of time goes by and then an assessment evaluation that, oh, I did actually, you know, use these three things or what have you. Very cool. Yeah.
I have that poem. I'm going to share it with you. There you go. It's in the chat. I'm always happy to read my poems out loud, but, you know, sometimes that's too much poetry.
Well, you're talking to an English major here, so there's no such thing as too much poetry. From my perspective.
Brent, are you a poetry lover?
You know, no.
That's all right. Most of my poems, I'll read them to my dad, and he's like, it's good. I don't know what it means.
I love a good limerick.
Oh, that's so good. Yes, the poetry slam. That's right, Joe.
Ooh, I see a new show coming on all of a sudden.
There's, oh, my.
Thursday mornings.
might be more of an after hours thing.
Yeah.
Depending on how many people decide to complete Joe's suggestion for the starting line for a limerick. There once was a trainer from Nantucket.
Oh, geez.
Oh, anyway.
I think with that, we might have to call it a day before things get out of hand on the idiotic poetry slam. Thank you so much, Amy.
Yeah, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
Any contact info that you've got where you want people to connect with you besides your poetry page, toss those into the chat, your LinkedIn or your Twitter or whatever you would, whatever you want to share.
Absolutely.
Awesome conversation. And we talk a lot about tying things to the business goal, et cetera, as a starting point in a lot of cases for where we should be looking at as trainers, et cetera. But a little piece of the equation is helping people understand how something is tied to the business goal and getting the management team involved in that. And understanding that's a pretty satisfactory and a pretty solid way to make sure that you're closing that loop. So very cool, gang. Join us for next week's conversation too. And in the meantime, have a great rest of the week, everybody, and we'll dance on out of here.
We will. And don't forget to join us in the LinkedIn group. I dropped the link in the chat. Thank you all so much for hanging out. It was such a great, great show today. Thanks again, Amy. And thanks everybody in the chat. Boy, I saw a lot of new faces I haven't seen in a while. So good times, everybody. Thanks for hanging out. And we will see you next time.
Thanks, all.
Thanks, everybody.
Everybody get your groove on. Enjoy your day.